Hi, very good morning. I'm Dr. Janak Patel, MD, general physician. My video lectures are mainly for educative purpose. They'll be useful for fourth year student in oral exams, in theory exams, as well as during internship and while you do your private practice. Some of the lecture may be useful for first year, second year, and third year student also. Today I am going to take one topic, which is on one of the diuretic we call chlorthalidone, which is thiazide like diuretic. It is not thiazide diuretic, but it is thiazide like diuretic. So we'll be talking on that. And it is the most common molecule which is being utilized nowadays in treatment of hypertension. So now we almost say that chlorthalidone is a first line of treatment as a monotherapy or as a dual therapy for treatment of hypertension. Also, it is one of the treatment in person with congestive heart failure or with volume overload. So we'll be talking on chlorthalidone, when to use, why to use, etc. We'll be discussing under common heading, that is introduction, mechanism of action, indications, contraindications, and side effects. Diuretics are the drug of choice nowadays as a monotherapy and as add-on therapy. And there are guidelines which were being published by ADA in 2020. There are guidelines, Indian guidelines, which were published in 2019 and 2020. We'll be just brushing up a little bit of that side. So ADA 2020 says that if initial blood pressure is between 140-90 to 160-100, start with monotherapy. After lifestyle management. And if the lifestyle management does not give you a result, you along with that lifestyle management, you will have to add a monotherapy. And if there is albuminuria, start straightforward with ACE inhibitor. But if there is no albuminuria, you can start any one of these three groups, that is ACE inhibitor ARB or CCB or thiazide. So thiazide becomes one of the monotherapy in treatment of hypertension. And as far as dual therapy is concerned, it is one of the drug. As there are a lot of trials which are being there on a thiazide, thiazide is one of the diuretic which is a drug of choice even in combination as a dual therapy. And then as even a triple drug combination, along with ARB, CCB, and diuretic, thiazide is a drug of choice. But as chlorthalidone has got little super hand above thiazide, chlorthalidone is now becoming a drug of choice above thiazide groups. This is Indian guidelines. If person is younger than 55, as a step 1 ACE inhibitor, as a step 2 ACE inhibitor plus either CCB or diuretic. Now good number of time a dual combination of ACE inhibitor with diuretic is becoming a drug of choice. And in a step 3, it is a drug of choice. Yes, instead of thiazide now, chlorthalidone is becoming a common drug of choice. And in older individual more than 55 years, instead of ACE inhibitor, CCB or diuretic becomes a monotherapy. As a step 2, along with ACE inhibitor, CCB or diuretic. And in step 3, all the three, that is ACE inhibitor, CCB and diuretic. And among diuretic, thiazide and chlorthalidone. Now chlorthalidone has got little super hand above thiazide groups. In uncomplicated, diuretic can be utilized as a monotherapy or as a dual combination or as a triple combination. You can see here. Even in person with diabetic, as a monotherapy or dual combination and as a triple combination. Even a person with hypertension and coronary artery disease, in initial therapy as a dual combination or as a triple combination in presence of coronary artery disease. In person with reduced ejection fraction, that is heart failure with reduced ejection fraction in presence of hypertension, as initial therapy followed if in step 2, again it is a drug of choice. But in this, loop diuretics are the first drug of choice rather than thiazide or chlorthalidone. In CKD, again, loop diuretics are first drug among diuretics, and then comes second group of drugs in diuretic will be thiazide or chlorthalidone. In case of atrial fibrillation, in step 2, in triple combination, diuretic can be utilized. And among those diuretic, again, in atrial fibrillation, the first drug of choice will be loop diuretics, and then second line will be thiazide or chlorthalidone. You can see here, in a non-compelling indication, again, in a non-elderly, non-black, thiazide is used as a monotherapy. In non-elderly black people, thiazide is also used as monotherapy. And you can see here, chlorthalidone is preferred over thiazide because there are certain advantages of chlorthalidone over thiazide. While in an elderly group of people, first drug of choice is CCB. And again in that CCB, dihydropyridine group of CCB. Now little idea regarding chlorthalidone. Chlorthalidone is thiazide-like diuretic, but not thiazide diuretic. Pharmacologically almost similar, like hydrochlorothiazide, or what we call as a thiazide diuretic. So pharmacologically almost identical action. Chlorthalidone has got a structure which we usually describe as 2-chloro, 5-1-hydro, 3-oxy, 2-H-ions, isoindole, benzene sulfonamide. This is the entire word which is being utilized. Now we know that the thiazide diuretic are acting via sodium and chloride, what we call the co-transporter, which blocks sodium chloride transport, and thus it is not reabsorbed, resulting into increased excretion of sodium and chloride in urine. And further, because of sodium and chloride excretion, it will end up with increased urine output, leading to decrease in blood volume, or we call hypovolemia, hyponatremia, hypochloremia. Along with sodium and chloride loss, there is even potassium is being lost, and that will end up with hypokalemia. Even magnesium is being lost, so that will end up with hypomagnesemia. So we will have hyponatremia, hypokalemia, hypomagnesemia. So these three goes hand in hand, and that is the action of thiazide group of diuretics. Hydrochlorothiazide and chlorthalidone are going to act via sodium and chloride pump, that is we call symporter, which is present in a distal convoluted tubule, resulting into loss of sodium and chloride. Along with that, water is lost, potassium is lost, magnesium is also lost. And thus, there is a decrease in plasma volume, decrease in extracellular fluid, and because of decrease in the plasma volume, fall in cardiac output and fall in blood pressure. And that is how it gives the beneficial effect in hypertension. There are good number of studies which shows that chlorthalidone is a potent inhibitor of carbonic anhydrase, which is elevated in hypertensive patient by epinephrine. So increase in chloride and bicarbonate exchange leads to increased vascular activity, so increase in risk of stroke. Also, chlorthalidone inhibits VGC, that is responsible for increased permeability of vascular cell, leads to pulmonary edema and congestive heart failure. So also chlorthalidone will be useful in a person with congestive heart failure and pulmonary edema. There are two other additional benefits as far as the chlorthalidone is concerned. As a short term, it reduces the plasma volume. And in a long term, it reduces the peripheral vascular resistance by producing vasodilatation. So it has got two main action: reduction in the plasma volume by loss of sodium and chloride along with water, and on peripheral blood vessels, it produces a vasodilatation, thus reducing peripheral vascular resistance and creates fall in blood pressure. And because of decrease in plasma volume also, there is a fall of blood pressure. By acting at the level of carbonic anhydrase level, chloride and bicarbonate exchange is affected, which will have an effect on catecholamine and thrombin-mediated platelet aggregation. And as this is reduced, platelet aggregation is reduced, it has got beneficial effect in stroke and MI. Also, vascular contractility is also being improved, and that will produce reduction in a stroke and MI. Chlorthalidone, by acting on, we have already shown you, by acting on VGC, that is growth factor, angiogenesis, and thus reduction in a stroke and MI. It has got also improved function of endothelium, and thus it has got beneficial effect as far as reduction in stroke and MI. Also, it takes part in reversal of LVH and vascular remodeling. Also, it produces peripheral vasodilatation, and thus it decreases the vascular resistance and helps in vascular remodeling and remodeling of LVH. Also, at the level of kidney, it decreases the albumin excretion. So it improves the kidney function, and it is beneficial in end-stage renal disease, as well as TGF-beta also helps in improving end-stage renal disease as well as in vascular remodeling. These are all we call as a pleiotropic effects. Beneficial effects apart from diuresis and peripheral vasodilatation. As it is acting at the level of vascular resistance, growth factor, and vascular permeability, it will be beneficial in pulmonary edema and congestive heart failure. This is another beneficial effect of chlorthalidone, which is not seen with thiazide group of diuretics. So this is the reason why chlorthalidone has got little super hand over thiazide group of diuretics. These are called pleiotropic effects. And as it has got decrease in stroke, MI and LVH, the mortality is reduced. It is also improving pulmonary edema and congestive heart failure. And because of that improvement also, the mortality is reduced. This is an additional benefit apart from other benefit which is being given by clothalidone. Now, there are certain precautions you have to keep it in mind. Whenever you use the clothalidone in presence of renal impairment, means if already the person has got a decreased GFR, and if GFR is reduced less than 30, it can precipitate acute renal failure. And in presence of heart failure and chronic CKD, it can precipitate acute renal failure. So a person who has got a CKD and heart failure, use clothalidone with caution. Indirectly, we say that in presence of stage 3, stage 4 and stage 5, and along with heart failure, clothalidone is almost contraindicated. And when you use clothalidone in a larger doses, no doubt it is a low ceiling diuretic, but it can produce a void loop depletion. And by producing void loop depletion, it can precipitate hypotension. And secondary to hypotension, it can precipitate AKI and worsen what we call as CKD. As far as metabolic effect is concerned, apart from electrolyte imbalance, it increases uric acid level, cholesterol level, triglyceride level, and calcium level, like thiazide diuretics. And also, there is impairment of a glucose tolerance. Hence, clothalidone should not be utilized in presence of gout, severe hyperlipidemia, and hypercalcemia. Also, it should not be, you should have a caution regarding a pre-diabetic and in an uncontrolled diabetic person, use of clothalidone. As far as electrolyte is concerned, it will produce hypokalemia, hypochloremia, hypomagnesemia, hyponatremia, like thiazide group of diuretics. But the percentage of this is relatively less as compared to thiazide groups. Secondary to hypokalemia, it can produce muscle weakness, fatigue, and cardiac arrhythmias, which can be lethal. And secondary to hyponatremia and hypovolemia, person can have hypotension, dizziness, etc. So if we summarize the side effects, because of decreased sodium reabsorption, potassium, magnesium, chloride, and H-ion reabsorption, it will end up with hyponatremia, hypokalemia, hypomagnesemia, hypochloremia. All these are hypo. And secondary to H-ion reabsorption, which is being affected, metabolic alkalosis, and urine will be acid. As far as reabsorption of calcium is concerned, it will end up with hypercalcemia. Hence, this can be a drug utilized in calcium stones, but it is contraindicated if the person is already having hypercalcemia. It should be also avoided in presence of gout because it can end up with hyperuricemia, and it elevates cholesterol and triglyceride, hence also contraindicated if there is a severe hyperlipidemia, and also it impairs glucose tolerance. Hence, you should have a regular checkup for blood sugar and HbA1c. And in presence of uncontrolled diabetes, you should be more cautious. Apart from electrolyte imbalance, metabolic, hypovolemia, etc., there are some side effects which should be kept in mind. Secondary to hypotension, headache, dizziness. It can produce GI upsets like diarrhea, constipation, and hypersensitive reaction, or we call photosensitivity, because it has got sulfa molecule. We already mentioned all these side effects like potassium, hyperuricemia, hyperlipidemia, hyperglycemia, rash, urticaria, which is hypersensitive reactions, paresthesia, vertigo, loss of appetite, nausea, vomiting, etc. are some of the common GI side effects. So that should be kept in mind. Chlorothalidone is available in different strengths. As far as hypertension is concerned, the commonest strength which is being utilized is 12.5 and 6.25. And for edema, usually the dose what is being given is a little larger dose, 50 up to 100 milligram. Now when you go above 25 milligram, the side effects chances increases. Hence, higher the dose, you will have to be cautious for uric acid, lipids, glucose, they will be elevated. While you will have electrolyte imbalance like hyponatremia, hypomagnesemia, hypokalemia, hypochloremia, and metabolic alkalosis. This should be kept in mind. And calcium level will be also elevated. All this should be kept in mind. You can see here, there's a little advantage of chlorothalidone over hydrochlorothiazide because chlorothalidone has got a long half-life. Duration of action is almost, half-life is 40 hours, hence duration of action is almost 24 to 48 hours, while hydrochlorothiazide has got half-life 6 to 9, and hence duration of action is only 12 hours. So chlorothalidone has got more half-life, more duration of action. So keep that thing in mind, but you should also keep that higher the dose, chances of electrolyte imbalance, metabolic disturbances is very, very common. Indication as far as chlorothalidone is concerned, heart failure in elderly person, isolated systolic hypertension, diabetic with hypertension, etc. It can be utilized in stage 1 hypertension, coronary artery disease, LVH, where the patient is having a risk of stroke, heart failure, etc. This is an additional advantage. Because of pleiotropic effect, there is an additional advantage. Chlorothalidone is a good diuretic. There are some compelling indications of diuretic and particularly chlorothalidone over thiazide in presence of diabetes, coronary artery disease, heart failure, and recurrent stroke prevention. So it is utilized in hypertension with diabetes, hypertension with coronary artery disease, hypertension with heart failure, and the person who is at a risk of stroke. It is also one of the drug utilized in presence of heart failure with reduced ejection fraction. If person is having diabetes with hypertension, if a person is having a metabolic syndrome, isolated systolic hypertension, and elderly individual, in presence of, it has got a cardioprotective effect by reducing congestive heart failure, remodeling in LVH, as well as vascular remodeling, and even in presence of ischemic heart disease. It also reduces cerebrovascular stroke, hence it is a good drug for reducing stroke events. Pleiotropic effects like antiplatelet, angiogenesis, decreasing vascular permeability, hence it is beneficial in congestive heart failure, left ventricular failure, pulmonary edema, etc. So these are all additional advantage of chlorothalidone. But again, repeating, while using a chlorothalidone, higher the dose, the chances of electrolyte imbalance like hyponatremia, hypokalemia, hypomagnesemia, hypochloremia, with loss of H ions, it can end up with metabolic alkalosis, should be kept in mind. Also, there are metabolic effects like hyperuricemia, hyperglycemia, hyperlipidemia. So you should have a close observation regarding these three: uric acid, blood sugar, and lipids. They are elevated. Higher the dose and longer the use should be kept in mind. There are very minor side effects like GI side effects, which are minor. Risk of combined cerebrovascular events, which includes death from congestive heart failure or coronary artery disease, non-fatal MI, revascularization procedures, angina, congestive heart failure, peripheral arterial disease, was significantly reduced when patient was given clothelidone. And clothelidone has got little advantage over amlodipine, being dual mode of action, longer half-life, better ambulatory blood pressure control, better effect on systolic blood pressure, decreased risk of heart failure and hospitalized heart failure and fatal heart failure, CV risk reduction, pleiotropic benefits, only antihypertensive with strong mortality benefits, and lesser risk of edema, which increases with amlodipine. Higher the dose of amlodipine, chances of ankle edema and volume overload increases. So in summary, Pfizer diuretic reduces blood pressure and have proven a cardiovascular benefit. Thiazide produces significant electrolyte and metabolic adverse events we already mentioned. Chlorthalidone is more potent and has a longer half-life and reduces blood pressure more effectively than hydrochlorothiazide. Hence, nowadays the chlorthalidone is more utilized as compared to hydrochlorothiazide. And chlorthalidone may provide superior cardiovascular prevention compared to hydrochlorothiazide. Furosemide belongs to a loop diuretic, hence it is indicated in edema and acute pulmonary edema, mainly what we call congestive heart failure, left ventricular failure. Potassium sparing are utilized in edema, congestive heart failure, etc., to counteract the potassium loss due to thiazide or loop diuretics. So usually spironolactone is combined with loop diuretics or with thiazide group of diuretics. Hydrochlorothiazide and chlorthalidone are the first line of treatment in hypertension as a monotherapy, particularly in elderly individuals. So I end my lecture here. If you like this video, please press button like, subscribe, and if you feel it is useful, you can share with your friends. I hope this lecture will be helpful to you in your theory as well as oral exam, more beneficial during your internship and during your private practice. I thank you all for taking out time. I know that your time is valuable, and I appreciate you for spending some of the time with me. This is one molecule which is utilized every day in and out, and one of the most common molecule used as a monotherapy or as a combination therapy in treatment of hypertension and in person hypertension with congestive heart failure or in congestive heart failure. So I end my lecture here. Again, I thank you all for taking out time.